So welcome to Tesla Talks episode 3. I'm very excited to be here with Benita from The People Who Share.
That's it.
And she has been on my radar for years now, and very much engaged with a sharing economy. And to be honest, I'm not really sure what that's all about. So would you introduce yourself and just tell me, you know, what The People Who Share is, please?
Yeah, so I'm Benita Matofska. I'm a social change maker, and I'm a sharing economy expert, and I founded The People Who Share, which is a charity. We've been going since 2011, and we're all about helping people access shared resources, and we really believe in the power of sharing to change lives and change the world.
Great.
And we believe that sharing, and by building a sharing economy, that's one that's built around the sharing of human and physical resources, that actually we can really build a more caring economy that suits people and planet, that really puts people and planet at the heart.
Yeah, lovely, lovely. And what would be the, you know, if there were certain things that people share or really understand the concept of sharing, what are those things that people really?
Well, you know, I think about sharing in terms of, so you've got physical things that people can share.
Yeah.
So goods,
yeah.
For example, we know that there are something like £3.5 trillion worth of idle goods in the world. And that's everything from houses right the way through to food that's wasted.
Yeah.
So actually, when you start to think about some of the global problems that we have, the complex problems of poverty, we actually have enough food in this world to feed everybody. Some of these problems like hunger and poverty actually don't need to exist.
Yeah.
We've got everything that we need to solve these problems. But the problem is that we need a more sharing culture and a sharing economy, actually both an infrastructure that enables that sharing to happen. And also we need to elevate the status of sharing.
Mm-hmm.
So rather than becoming obsessed with consumption and ownership,
yeah,
and where people feel this need to, this compulsion to shop and to own goods,
yeah,
actually when you start to think about, well, does that really, what does that really say about me as a person?
Yeah.
Whereas
yeah,
if I'm sharing,
yeah,
actually that should really be elevated.
Yeah, no, I love that, because I mean, you know, money is really just a kind of man-made concept, and ultimately it's just an exchange of energy, right?
Well, absolutely.
So your bartering kind of mentality, which is sharing. Sharing is caring.
Sharing is definitely caring.
And I really love that. I mean, we try and do a lot more of that in our, yeah, I mean, buying things from eBay rather than from...
Absolutely, you know, absolutely. Yeah, when I started this work, which is pretty much a decade ago now, and I made this pledge that I wouldn't buy new things.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the things that I have are from clothes swaps, they're from charity shops, they're pre-loved in some way, they might be bought on eBay, they might be found like this jacket in Snooper's Paradise in Brighton. I'm rather fond of this one.
It's really nice.
You know, and I love the idea that we have something for a period of time. It has its own story. It has meaning to us.
Yeah.
And when we don't need it anymore, actually somebody else can benefit from that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's gorgeous. What would you say you do in your own life? Like, so you said you've been in the kind of in the sector for 10 years. In fact, leading the way for 10 years, actually. But in your own life, like, really bring it back to you as a personal thing that you do. What did you start doing?
Well, I started with clothes because I've always been really interested in fashion.
Yeah.
And so, you know, for me it was about, okay, well, do I actually need to go and spend fortunes on designer clothes? Actually, no, I don't.
Yeah.
And it was very much about, you know, taking a really long, hard look at my life. And back in 2008, when a lot of this was happening, we had a global recession. It was a period when I was making big transitions, as were lots of people, and really,
yes,
sort of reevaluating.
Yes.
You know, what's this all about? What can my contribution to the world be? I worked in television for over 20 years in broadcasting.
Okay.
I started out as a journalist, and I worked on programs like Rough Guide to the World, and traveled the world, and had an extraordinary time, and made some really interesting documentaries. But I reached a point where I wanted to give back, and I wanted to do something that was positive.
Mm.
And I didn't really want to be sitting in an ivory tower with, you know, people working in this industry where they didn't even know the price of a pint of milk.
Mm.
They were so completely out of touch. And also, I didn't want to be making these derivative formatted programs that, you know, car crash television with these kind of forced headlines, sensational tabloid headlines. I just didn't want to be doing that anymore. And any time I tried to make something that I considered to be of purpose and value, any kind of documentary or factual series, it was really difficult to get that commissioned. And so I reached a point where I said, actually, this is not where my skills and talents are really best served, and I want to make a difference, I want to have an impact. And you know, it's that classic sort of cliche of coming up to the age of 40 and saying, what's it all about? And so I left television and I went into the charity sector. And that's really, it was during that period of time I was head of global entrepreneurship at Enterprise UK, and my job was all about inspiring and equipping young people to be entrepreneurial. And it was during that time, because of this ridiculous title, and my friends used to joke, I sounded like, you know, I was head of the world, head of global entrepreneurship, what does that mean? And so I would be invited to present at all these very kind of, you know, influential events, very grand events. And one of those, and probably, you know, the one that's had the biggest kind of mark on my life and really sparked this whole kind of sharing obsession that I have, was the One Young World Congress. And I found myself literally sharing a platform with Desmond Tutu. I mean, what do you say when you're backstage with Desmond Tutu? You know, it's quite an extraordinary experience. And so for me, you know, from then on, it was very much about what can I be doing to really build a global campaign. It was always intended to be a global campaign that is about building more sustainable, caring, sharing economy.
Wow, that's amazing. So, I mean, winding 10 years forward from where you started, and it sounds like you've had some amazing experiences. Where were you at? What's your impact?
I created something called Global Sharing Week, and this year in 2019, it takes place from the 16th of June to the 22nd of June. And last year we had, so it's the largest annual event about sharing and sharing the sharing economy.
A global event.
So people all over the world get involved. In fact, we reach over 100 million people. Last year we had 456 registered events in 247 cities in 39 countries. And that's everything from a tiny community book swap to, you know, a whole street that is cordoned off to no cars and where there's all kinds of things are shared, to pop-up picnics, disco soups where people come together and they share dance and they share surplus food, through to skills exchanges, all kinds of events, community events where people are coming together, they're collaborating, they're sharing in their communities and also in their businesses. We have a lot of business engagement, a lot of entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs get involved in the week. It's really open to everybody, no matter what sector you're in. And we have a website, globalsharingweek.org. We've just opened for registration, so anybody can go and register an event and find events near them. And it really is an opportunity for people to engage. And this year our theme is about the power of sharing to change the world, to change lives. I've become quite obsessed with this whole idea of change makers. And who are the change makers that are building a sharing economy? And I've spent the last 3 years working on a book called Generation Share, which will be published for Global Sharing Week this year. And I've been working with Sophie Scheinwald, a good friend of mine and phenomenal photographer, because what we wanted to do was to visually capture these incredible stories, to inspire people, to inspire more sharing in the world, but to demonstrate that these ideas are not just ideas. You know, people are actually delivering these incredible projects and are changing lives and saving lives. You know, from a girl in the slums in Mumbai called Artie Naik, who actually wrote to me following the crowdfunding campaign for the Travel for Generation Share. And she said to me, my name is Artie Naik, I'm a slum-based girl. I've started Saki School for Girls Education, all based on sharing principles. I am Generation Share. Will you come to India and tell my story? And Sophie and I said, well, we obviously have to go. We hadn't raised enough money to go to India, but there's always a way. I suppose credit cards can come in handy sometimes. And off we went. In November 2017, Sophie and I went off to India and to Mumbai. And we told a number of stories in India about different people that are engaged in different sharing projects. And it really demonstrates that, you know, whether we've got two women who've set up a breast milk bank saving the lives of premature babies and sick babies in the UK.
Yeah, yeah.
So through the sharing of breast milk.
Yes.
Right the way through to another incredible entrepreneur who has set up the Oscar Foundation. Mm-hmm. And Ashok Rathod is using football as a way to engage slum-based kids in education. So through their love of football, they come to play football, but in order to play football and play as part of this team that's become quite prestigious in India, mm-hmm. they have to complete a certain number of hours per week in an after-school program.
Okay.
Which for those young people who would otherwise have dropped out of school, they would have a life of crime and poverty and no future. Mm-hmm. This form of sharing is really giving them a future.
Yeah, lovely. So they're giving back and then they're getting to engage with something that is fulfilling.
Absolutely.
Yeah, really nice, really nice. Well, I mean, that's amazing. So people just need to come to your website, maybe come up with some ideas about, you know, how they can share within
Absolutely.
That week.
Absolutely.
And register. And then do you support the registration in any ways?
We do. So we have, there are lots of resources on the website. There are lots of how-to guides, how to put on a clothes swap. Lots and lots of guides. We partner with Shareable in the US, who've produced some phenomenal content around some of the practicalities of how to set up these events and how to build sharing communities. So there's lots and lots of information for people that, you know, want to do this. We also have, if people want to volunteer with the people who share, we're mm-hmm. always looking for more volunteers to come on board and work with us. I'm Benita at thepeoplewhoshare.com. And at Benita Matofska on Twitter. So I'm pretty easy to find.
Yeah, and we'll have all of these details at the bottom of the video as well.
Fantastic.
In the post. So
fantastic.
People will be able to
and
find you.
Generation Share is available now for pre-order on Amazon. One of the things that I should say about the book, it's all printed from waste materials. It's fully compostable.
Good.
And each book educates a slum-based girl. So we're supporting Artie Naik's project.
Okay, nice.
And also plants a tree. We're working with the Eden Reforestation Project.
How are you?
So by virtue of the fact that we're putting this product out there in the world, we're working with non-profit publishers, Policy Press, mm-hmm. who are publishers with purpose.
Yep.
They publish books about social action and social issues. And for us, this is all about social change and the difference that we can make by bringing positive stories. Because another aspect of this is that, you know, we feel that given the where we are in the world and the times that we live in, mm-hmm. we need to take people on a journey of hope. Mm-hmm. And there are so many positive stories that we never hear about. And Generation Share is really seeking to bring those positive stories to public attention.
Very nice, very nice. So there's content rich as well in terms of your website and the book.
And the book, absolutely.
And are you, it sounds like there's a movie coming. I mean, is there anything in the pipeline for videos and things?
Sophie and I have always said that Generation Share is a coffee table book.
Yeah.
But in the first instance, that's what we wanted to produce, this sustainable product to start getting the message out there.
Yeah.
But the intention has always been that, you know, we've created this brand Generation Share, and what we want to do is, you know, there will be photography exhibitions.
Yeah.
We're looking at, you know, documentaries and television and drama, certainly.
Yeah, because so, it feels very visual. I mean, the book, it sounds amazing.
Absolutely.
But maybe that book is just a stepping stone.
The stepping stone.
Particularly with, you know, the slums in India. I mean, they're just so rich and vibrant and beautiful. I mean, Katie and I, who's the editor and my wife, we lived in Mumbai before we moved to Brighton. So, yeah, we really got to experience that way of life. And it's so entrepreneurial, India.
Incredibly
entrepreneurial. They're way ahead of us.
And I tell you what's been phenomenal on this journey is that for every story that we found and for every change maker that I've interviewed, there are hundreds more out there.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, there are so many incredible change makers.
Yeah.
And for me, I'm on this mission to bring these stories to an audience because these are stories that need to be heard.
Yeah.
We spend way too much time focusing on negative. Definition of news has become negative.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And actually, news should be positive.
Yeah, it should be enriching and enlivening and inspiring. And
of course, you know, we have many people out there who are thriving.
Yes.
Through sharing, by being connected to people in communities and actually looking at the positive change that they can create. And this is regardless of what circumstances you come from.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, when I consider Artie Naik started her school from a single room slum house. She still lives in that very same slum house with her family. Nine people living, you know, in this slum house.
Gosh.
And now she's educated over 600 girls and recently started a programme for mothers. So it just shows you, amazing. Absolutely against the odds.
What a pioneer she is.
What a pioneer. And, you know, I believe there's a change maker in everybody.
Yes.
It's about that drive and those influences and how we look at the world around us and say, we can make a difference.
Very good. Very well. I mean, I'm absolutely in awe and inspired. Thank you. That's amazing. So, I mean, anybody that's watching this video is going to connect with you, I'm sure, because they'll be feeling inspired too. I like to do something very indulgent at the end.
Oh, I don't mind a bit of indulgence.
And ask you if you would, in the theme of sharing, maybe share one of your most favourite records
That's always a tricky one, isn't it?
And we'll hopefully get to play it on our system in here.
So many choices, and I sing.
So many choices.
I sing in a community choir as well, called the Dulcetone. So I love a good tune now and again.
Great. So we're going to hear you sing as well, then.
All right.
Hopefully.
Well, I don't know. Maybe possibly. Okay. This is really difficult, but I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to go for a mashup. So that's a form of sharing, isn't it? Let's
face it.
I'm going to go for a mashup.
Yeah.
So then I actually don't have to choose one track. I can choose two. It's quite good, or maybe more. And this is by the Hot Sardines. And it's called, well, the first part of the mashup is by Mir Bister Shane. So it's a bit of an old Yiddish number, actually.
Okay.
You can't beat a bit of Yiddish.
Yeah.
And often I find when you can't quite find a word to express something, I turn to the Yiddish language, because then no one knows what I'm talking about. But it's very expressive. So by Mir Bister Shane, you'll recognise the tune, I'm sure. And then it also kind of mashes up with Diggy Diggy Do, which you may not have heard of. I don't know. Maybe you'll recognise it.
It sounds wonderful, though.
But it's very easy to learn. So I'm going to, let me see if I can find it here. It sounds very obscure, doesn't it? But,
so this mashup of songs will kind of sum up your perhaps
it does.
slightly not split personalities, because that sounds awful, but your range of personalities.
Well, exactly. There we go. With a bit of eccentricity thrown in there.
Yeah, of course. Brilliant.
Of all the boys. It's not just about boys, by the way.
Of all boys I've known, and I've known some. First met you
now,
with love.
Now, you can't be a bit of jazz as well.
I hope you like the world was new to me. You're swell, I'll admit you deserve expressions that fissure. Rack my brain, hoping to explain the things you do to me.
Maybe.
Please let me explain. By Mir Bister Shane means that you're grand. By Mir Bister Shane, again and again, meaning you're the fairest in the land. I could say Bella, even say from the Irish language. I'm leaked out with the show. How wonderful you are, I try to explain. By Mir Bister Shane,
I actually know this in Yiddish, so I'm like, living on Yiddish.
It's fun.
I always like a bit of fun. Yeah, you've got to have a bit of fun.
It's got a nice vibe to it.
Here we go, we're about to mash up.
Okay, into the second bit.
Stunning day. It's absolutely gorgeous. The sky is blue.
That's sorry you guys, you can't, well, you can see the sun coming through actually.
It's
can't
gorgeous, see out the window it's like well, blossom on the trees, it's absolutely
it is. It's a rich, glorious, rich
glorious. Amazing.
Well, thank you so much for coming to talk with me. It's a real privilege to have you in the car, part of our Tesla Talk series.
Yeah,
thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
Please let me explain about me a bit of shame means that you're grand. About me a bit of shame, again and again, means that you're the fairest in the land. I could say bellum bellum, he'd have say for the bar. He's like a jolly gun, know how wonderful you are.
Benita, thank you.
Thanks for sharing.